Welcome to this video on what goes into a research proposal, which is about research proposal genres, and this is part of our series on writing the research proposal. Although there are common components to research and thesis proposals, there are also many differences. Some disciplines or programs will require you to include different sections, or perhaps to change the order that against what I'm presenting here. So for example, in engineering, you might have to include a section on materials, and in other disciplines, you might not separate the literature review from the methodology. Another example would be that PhD level research requires a more emphasis on originality than master's level proposals. So you'll need to interpret what I'm going to show you here and find out about what your department or discipline requires. Read examples if you can, and talk to other people in your field. But there are often key components to a thesis or research proposal, and these are the common components, and I'm going to go through each one individually. Let's begin with the title. The title, of course, is very important because this is what the reader sees first. What goes into the title will really depend on your preference, your supervisor, your committee, and also the discipline or field that you're working in. Some disciplines want the title to represent all the concepts. So, for example, self-regulation, goal orientation, and academic achievement of secondary students in online university courses, that shows all the concepts in this particular study. Other disciplines will allow a general topic. So there you would just give the broad description of the topic, academic performance of first year university students, and it wouldn't include the specific concepts. And other disciplines allow for much more creativity in titles. But the main question you want to ask yourself is, if someone does a keyword search on the internet or on a database, will they find my research? Let's move on to the introduction section of the research proposal. And this would usually begin with a broad overview of the topic and then narrow down to the specific research problem. So the inverted pyramid is the shape that you're looking for here. So in the introduction, you're really orienting the reader to the project. So you want to include a really brief overview of all the details so that the reader isn't having to think, well, what is this about? And I've included some writing prompts here just to help you get started and to think about what should be included in here. So the reader's questions will include, this is what they want answered. Is where does the study take place? What is this research about? Why should I read any further? So that is the so what question. And they want to know what's coming next in the proposal. Part of what goes into the introduction section of a research proposal is the background to the problem. And this is where you build up the problem. So for example, if the research problem is writing is emotional, but emotions are often not recognized as part of the graduate research journey, then the background would include a discussion on why writing is emotional. So it would lead up to that problem. Then included in the introduction section as well, you would have the problem purpose statements and questions. So the background would lead to the problem purpose statements and questions. And in my experience, it's very important that that this is included, that the problem purpose statement is included, because it shows how the study is being conceptualized, and it should be included within the first three pages of the research proposal. So if you include the problem purpose statement and questions within the first three pages, you will offset these questions that readers will ask. What is the problem? What is the purpose of this research? What are the key research questions? Do the questions align with the problem? What is the scope of the research project? Is the study doable? After the introduction, you move into a literature review section. And here, you want to situate your study within the broader literature. And you're really setting up the rationale for the study. You're identifying the knowledge gap, what is known and what isn't known. And you're also evaluating this literature in some way. And what you're showing for your proposal assessor is that you have read deeply and broadly. You might also explain the conceptual framework if that is relevant. And your reader's questions will be, has the student read enough to inform the study? Is the study situated within a literature? Does the student have a good understanding of the literature, the key debates, the contestation? Has the student been able to describe and evaluate or critically assess what that person's read? Is there a conceptual framework in there? Am I convinced by the arguments in this literature review? The section that usually follows the literature review is the methodology. And readers of the research proposal want a brief but really thorough explanation of the methods or methodology so that they can then assess your capacity to conduct this research and the feasibility of the project. So what goes into this section is the research paradigm, the design, data collection, and data analysis, something on validity or trustworthiness, and then there might be a range of optional sections. We have a video on this, and it goes through both qualitative and quantitative projects, so please have a look at that. But really, in this section, you are providing the step-by-step practicalities of how this data or how this research project will be operationalized. So the reader's questions for this section will be, is the methodology consistent with the rest of the study? Is the methodology appropriate? Is it doable logistically? Can this be done? Will the student have enough sources of data? Has the student thought through all the steps? And have other issues like data analysis, bias, subjectivity, validity, ethics, etc. been considered? Am I confident that the student can do the research according to this plan? Now, this is not always included, but I do think it's a good idea for both you and your committee to include a research strategy. And really what this is putting your plan of action to a timeline so that you can work out when things will take place. And you may not always stick to this, But it's a good idea for your committee to be able to see, or your supervisor to be able to see, if there are any pitfalls and they can help you. And if you don't stick to it, at least you have a plan of action that you can then adapt. So one of the most commonly used mechanisms for doing a schedule or timeline is a Gantt chart. And this is an example where you would identify milestones and set those milestones to a calendar. And the reader's questions here: has the student thought through the time required for each step of the project, and have the logistics of the project been thought out? Now, there may be a number of optional sections in a proposal, and this really depends on your topic and on your discipline or field. So they could include more than what I've listed here. But these would be things like, if ethics is important, you would have a section on ethical clearances. If you're doing insider research, you might have a section on researcher bias or the role of the researcher. So for example, if you are a lecturer conducting research on your own classes, how will you account for your bias? You might include a section on the significance of the research. You might include a section on the potential research impact, and so on. Readers' questions for this section is, what else have writers included to show they are capable and equipped to do this research? The concluding paragraph is quite an important paragraph, because even though you provide a summary of the proposal, it's much more than a summary. Really what you're doing is emphasizing the key arguments that you've made in the proposal, and you're reminding the reader how important this research is. The reader's question here will be, am I convinced of the need for this study? And am I confident that the student is equipped to do this research? After the text of the research proposal, you will most often find the references. References refer to those texts that have been directly referred to, those sources that have been directly referred to in the text. A bibliography is where you include sources that you haven't directly included. Now, some departments may ask you to include a bibliography so they can see what sources you will use in the future as well, so that they can assess your sources. It's very important that you pay attention to referencing conventions and formats, because your references are your evidence in this proposal. And if you don't pay attention and your referencing contains errors, then that creates an impression in your reader's mind about the kind of researcher you are. So it's very important to pay attention to detail with the referencing. So the reader's questions will be here: are the sources relevant and up to date? So they want to see current references. And are referencing conventions adhered to? You may want to include some appendices, which would come after the references. And here you would attach additional information, perhaps in-depth interview questions or a questionnaire instrument. You might include your Gantt charts here. If you had letters of permission or ethics letters, you would include this. But you don't have to have appendices, so don't go out and look for stuff to put in, but include it if you think it'll strengthen your proposal. So now we come to proposal length, and this is a very tricky question. How long is the research proposal? And it's tricky because this really depends on your program or field and discipline. So it could be anywhere from, 10 pages or even shorter to 35 pages. So I've given some page lengths here, but these are really quite arbitrary. And the most important thing, I think, is to look at the weighting. The weighting of the proposal is in the literature review and the methodology. So those are the really significant sections. And as I've suggested before, ask for what the requirements are in your institution. Talk to other people. If you can, look at examples of research proposals in your department and work out what is needed in your particular institution. Thank you very much for watching this video on what goes into the research proposal, which is part of our series on writing the research proposal.